And the simplest test that we do to measure properties, the mechanical properties, is a tensile test. And the test is conceptually very simple, that this blue rectangle in the middle is my sample. And it is, So this is, and the idea is that if I have a machine which can measure load and extension, then I can clamp this sample in that machine, impose a load of the sample, and from this measured I can calculate. Okay. And one of the properties that we measure is, and think about this, I want you to think about, nowadays we don't use them much, but sorry, before I go forward, let me just show you what the machine is. Okay? This is what the machine is like, typically, that looks like in a lab, and this is what the sample is like. What you see below is, this is the sample. So you take a strip, and we basically cut out a thin region in between. And the reason we give it this unusual shape is that this part right here is what is held by the machine, you know. So this is what goes into the grips, and these here are the grips. Okay, so this wide part goes inside, gets clamped by the grips, and then pulled. And most of the deformation is happening in now in this thin region, and this is where our interest is. This is where we look at, this is where we do the measurements, and this is where we take data from which we can analyze. So let me try and show you. I did not download it because Guru reminded me that this is all going to go into public domain, and I need not necessarily have permissions to show these things. But these are on YouTube. So I thought I'll at least show you one video of such an experiment, where now you can, this black strip is the sample. These massive things that you see at the top and bottom are the grips. And what you will see coming out on this white sheet here says stress versus strain, and this is what we are going to talk a little bit about, is the outcome of such a test. Okay, so let me take this forward a little bit. Yeah, again, I. Because there's a lot about what material it is on, and right now our interest is so much in what material it is and what it does. Our interest is in, well, when we get data from such a test, what do we do with it? Sorry, I should have read it from. Okay, so there. So now if you look carefully at the white part here, very soon data is going to start appearing on that as they pull it. Both the axes start at zero. You now see that is from the experiment. So the sample is getting pulled, and this is data from the experiment that is happening. And they'll keep pulling the experiment, pulling the sample. And you can see probably lines coming on this sample. So what they had done is they had put a coating on the sample. And as they're pulling it, the coating is getting cracked as the sample is getting pulled. We are not going to worry about any of that right now. I like it just because it lets you see that the sample is getting elongated. It lets you see that very easily. And this coating is peeling off or is breaking into small pieces as the sample is getting pulled more and more and more. So that's. experiment that you do. And to give you a very simple example that you can probably relate to is that think of your ballpoint pen, right? Have you do people still use a ball pen? You know, the one that goes like this, it has a spring inside it, right? Now we want that spring to be stiff enough to hold that clicker away, you know, when the spring is extended, but I still want it to be, when I want to click it down, the spring should be compliant that with one thumb and without tiring my thumb too much, I can just click it, you know, open and closed and open and closed very easily. That's one kind of spring that we see very commonly. We often have it on our office table and we go clickety-clackety clack. Sometimes people have an annoying habit of going click, click, click nonstop. The other extreme would be the kind of a spring which is as a shock absorber, right? You go into a pothole, and of course, there's a shock, but sitting inside the car, you don't feel it very much. And the more expensive the car, the better are the designs, the more, you know, robust is the shock holder, the shock absorber. The newer the car, the more robust is the shock absorber. And that is also a kind of a spring. Okay, it takes the shock, but it doesn't transfer that shock to the passenger. So now this must be a spring which doesn't go clickety clack. It's a lot more stiff than the kind of spring that we use, and it also damps that shock out. Okay, so now if you want to figure out, well, you know, I've got this sheet of metal. Is it good enough for me to make a spring that will go into a pen? And I've got another sheet of metal. Is it good enough to make a spring that can go into a car? I need to know how stiff those springs are likely to be. So I need to be able to cut samples like this that you see on the bottom right of your screen from that sheet of metal, test it, and measure this quantity called stiffness. Stiffness basically means that if I take something, if I take this, and I want to pull it. Let's assume this is 10 units and I want to pull it by 1 unit. How much load will it take? If it's very stiff, it'll take a lot of load to pull it by 1 unit. If it is not stiff, I pull it very easily. That's what stiffness tells me. Okay. And the reason I'm using the example of springs is because stiffness refers to elastic deformation. I pull it, I release it, it springs back. Okay, and that's what you want in your shock absorbers. You don't want them keep getting bent permanently every time you go through a pothole. Okay, so typically the cleaned up stress versus strain data, or you know, if any of you are from any of the backgrounds that I talked about, mechanical, civil, et cetera, this is what you see in a textbook. You see stress versus strain, a very nice smooth curve, and then these. In the analysis that you will be doing, you will be only interested in the elastic part of that data, which is this initial straight line. So don't worry about the red line. I drew it simply to say, look, a brittle ceramic, you know, the cups in which we drink coffee would behave like that red line. They would have none of this plastic deformation part. It load, and if you load it too much, it's going to break. But metals don't. So we are interested in this part of the curve where stress strain is elastic, and the slope of this is what I use to measure the stiffness. Okay, this is a stiffness, and the name that we give it, the engineering term for it, is modulus. To be very precise, it is Young's modulus, after a Mr. Young who was a material scientist. Okay, so this is called the Young's modulus. Higher the slope, the stiffer the spring. High slope meant for cars, low slope meant for your ballpoint pens. Now the question is, let's take a break from my slides. I think my slides are anyways going to be done. And I want to show you some of the data sets which you will use. Data sets which have been generated by our students who've done these experiments. Okay, this is strain versus stress data. Okay. But before you get to strain versus stress, let's look at what. So, if we do this test, we take this big machine, clamp the sample, pull it, generate data, and then try to make sense out of it. Raw data, which we are not going to trouble you with, but which you should still see, looks like this. Okay, so it says what kind of specimen. It was brass. What is the name of the file? When was it done? It's an old test done in 2011. Now, here are some interesting inputs. Somebody has already measured the cross-sectional area of the sample. So, if this was my sample, then somebody has already measured this, because I'm loading it like this. This is the face where the load is put, and the area of this face is already entered here. That's this 28.27433, and this shouldn't be millimeter, it should be millimeter square. And I think Jaya is probably going to touch a little bit about in measurement and so on. And I think Guru would have probably spoken to you already. If not today, then he will, about significant quantities. Does it make sense to say that the cross-sectional area is 28.27433 millimeter square? Gauge length, this middle pinned down section that I was talking about, somebody, the person who did this experiment, has already measured that length and entered it here, and they're saying, well, it is 25 millimeters. Exactly 25 millimeters. And then this is the experiment. There are several other things. This is the experimental data. The raw data is actually this. Okay, this is load. Column A is load in kilonewtons, which is being measured by a load cell. The second column is stroke, which is basically, you saw those massive grips. It is telling you how much are those grips moving. Okay, so, and this is again in millimeters. They have moved by 0.002 millimeters. Okay. And then there is extension. Okay. So this is change in length. How much is the change in length? And that's this. And now, stress and strain are calculated quantities. We take this load, we divide this by that cross-sectional area that we had separately measured, and get what load per unit area. This is the same as, in many ways, it is the same as pressure. That's this quantity. That is what you will use to plot. And here is strain. Strain is change in length divided by some reference length. And reference length for us is the gauge length that we were talking about. Now you see a very interesting thing, or I hope you notice that there is a very interesting thing, that in this column, stress goes 1.91, 1.48, 1.97, 2.98. It's more or less increasing. It fluctuates 4.91, 4.7, but it's mostly increasing. Look at strain, percentage strain. It's 0.00000, while stress has increased to 5.97. Okay, and then strain increases to 0.01 and stays at 0.01 for a while. Right? There. While the stress keeps on increasing. Okay? Look at load. Load also, there are still fluctuations. It goes 0.169, 0.205, 0.199, then comes down again. But again, on average, it is increasing. Right? So, why does this look like this? Because this is a ratio. This is a ratio of this divided by your reference length, which is fairly large compared to these tiny extensions. Okay? So, if we were to plot the final results look okay. This is the final result. The upper left plot And this is I've done this for aluminum, which is one of the data sets that you use. If you look at it all together on this scale, it looks all right, right? But remember, what you are going to eventually try to do is fit a, okay? And that's relatively easy for me to do, picking up a pen and drawing it on a graph which is plotted like this, because I can kind of see that, look, okay, this is the initial straight part. Okay, fine. And you know, then I'll say, okay, let's calculate the slope, 100 minus 50 divided by something over something. But that's not what you're trying to do. You have a set of data. Okay? And in this set of data, when you start plotting this, here I've plotted, I think, about the first 300 rows of your data. And this is what it looks like. I guess it's gone down too much. Hold on. Okay. These are the first 300 of your data sets. I'm just going to shift it up a little bit. This is what it looks like. Now, for strain doesn't change while stress increases. Look at these. Okay. So what should you do? Should you take averages, smooth them out? Should you keep them as it is and just fit a line through the middle of this? What's the best solution? And when you have this entire data and you're not using a plot, you're just processing data, because you don't want to keep plotting them and then by hand drawing lines to figure out slope. How do you figure out ends? Right? Because if you take too little, if you say, well, I'm just going to fit, you know, the first 300 data points as I have drawn, look at this. This would be susceptible to these problems in strain measurement and probably not representative of how stiff your spring actually is. Okay, but if you don't stop here and you keep going, you don't know where it has stopped. Well, you may end up drawing a line like this and calculating the slope of this line, or some line like this and calculating the slope of this line, all of which are erroneous. Okay, so the point that I'm trying to make is that this is an easy experiment. I think conceptually also this is very easy to understand, even if you've never done this experiment before. You know, you take a sample, you pull it, measure loads and displacements, and convert those loads and displacement to stress and strain using these relations. Stress is load over cross-sectional area, strain is extension over reference length. And once you have those plots, take the linear portion, fit to it, calculate the slope. And here is your stiffness or your Young's modulus. That's what you're going to be asked to do. However, in reality, each data set comes with its own potential sources of error and its own potential, you know, quirks, like the strain not changing for a long time while the stress keeps jumping up. Okay, so I think that is all that I wanted to talk about. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And if you have any, so all of these things you will cover in I think either today's session or maybe tomorrow's hands-on session. And if you have any queries about what I've spoken about till now, you may ask. Otherwise, my guess is that questions are going to arise when you actually start working with data. RTAs are more than competent to be able to answer all your questions. If not, you know, feel free to ask me the next time we meet, or feel free to send me an email or message or something, and I can answer those questions. So I'm going to stop talking now, and unless you have some questions, I think Jaya can take over.
Should I? Okay.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Then I'll start sharing my screen. Is it visible to you all?
Yes, Jaya.
Okay. Thanks.
Yes,
thanks, Preeta. I think it was a much needed introduction because I was going to start from where you left off. So you just currently saw a stress strain curve in a tensile test. And we talked about how to plot that curve. First of all, what you get is a load displacement response, and you can convert it into a stress and a strain. Strain is given by the total change in length over the original length, and stress is given by the force per unit area. So if this is a cylindrical sample you're talking about, then you know how to calculate the area if you're given if you can measure the dimensions of the beam. And the instrument measures something called a load cell, measures the force that is acting or the material is resisting as you know, pull it. So this is the stress strain curve that Professor Preeta Pant was talking about. And the discussion was about this regime, which is called the elastic regime, where you measure the slope, which is called as the Young's modulus. So what I will be talking about is the next point. Once you reach the end of this elastic regime, you reach what is called as an elastic limit. That is the point of no return for the material, in the sense that if you continue to deform this material beyond the so-called elastic limit, the material undergoes a permanent deformation or change of shape. So that is also important to measure, because it's again going to be a property that is tied to the material and the microstructure of that material. One can change that property if one desires so, by various processing techniques. Again, not something we will talk about, but this is a critical value that one needs to measure. It's also called as the yield strength. I will not distinguish between the elastic limit and the yield strength for the moment. There is a slight difference, but what it tells you is that beyond this point, if you continue to strain the material beyond this point, then it undergoes a permanent change of shape. So in that sense, the material has failed, because if you're, let's say, sitting on the chair that you're sitting, you only want it to undergo elastic deformation. I mean, invariably, it always undergoes elastic deformation, even though you may not be seeing it, because the deformation is very small. But you don't want it to deform permanently, right? Like, you want the chair to remain stable and not change its shape. So the failure stress in that sense can be called as the yield strength for a metallic material. And all the design engineers will make sure that the yield strength of the material is not exceeded. So they give a factor of safety such that this quantity is never exceeded. So precise measurement of this quantity is important. So one can, of course, do a tension test. And for certain applications, people also do a compression test. Now, one thing about a compression test is it's easier to do than a tensile test. You don't need the grips that Professor Preeta Pant was showing you. Like, for a tensile test, you need to fold the sample and pull it. But in a compression test, you can just place the sample on a flat base, and then you push down with the particular loading fixture, whatever you have. So there are some basic differences between a tension test and a compression test. And the reason I'm showing a compression test now is because all the data that I have, which is basically from my student Nidin's ongoing work, is all in compression. So more or less, the initial part remains the same. It has an elastic regime. It also has a yield point or at the elastic limit or what is called as yield strength. And then it continues to deform at a much different slope compared to the original. The original slope is the highest. If you continue to deform, it should have gone off like that. But the material now sort of undergoes yielding, and it drops off that load. So it's sort of relaxing here. So there is a different stress that it can take now. And the deformation being compressive, the specimen now, instead of becoming thinner and thinner in cross-section, it becomes thicker in cross-section and shorter in height. So that's the difference. But the definition of strain and stress remains the same for both. So we will move on from that, where we were looking at macro-scale samples, where you saw a large sample being tested, to micro-scale samples, because again, the data that I'm showing is at the micro-scale, and I'm bringing it up for a reason, that the measurement of the data and the accuracy of the data is very different when you measure at the micro scale and the macro scale, because the instrument itself happens to be different. Its least count is different, or its precision is different. Therefore, the errors associated with the measurements are different. And not just the instrument, but the sample that you make and then you test at the micro scale also will look very different, and therefore the error. So I will talk about it a little bit so as to make you familiar with the technique and the process of which data you're going to again analyze later, maybe today and tomorrow. So, but why are we looking at small lens scales? Because all our devices are becoming smaller, right? So all the materials, structures that we are making are also becoming smaller. So one needs to know whether the material continues to behave the same way it does at the large and the small lens scales. So usually you expect it to be the same, whatever be the size of the specimen, but people have found out that there are some major changes that occur at very small dimensions. If you take the sample to micron lens scale, less than the size of your hair, less than the diameter of the hair, or even lesser than that at nanometer lens scales, then people have seen that the material properties actually change. So the elastic modulus itself is known to change at very small lens scales. Now, I will not get into the details again of what this is, but this is something called grain size. In any specimen, in a solid, you have a microstructure associated with it, which means if you polish and etch that sample, you will see lots of these contrasts, and these boundaries are the grain boundaries. So you can call these individual regions where it is bounded by that, those things, as grains. So the grain size can be measured. That is also one of the things that you could measure and look at the deviation of. So when a material has a very small grain size in the regime of 20 nanometers and less, people have seen changes in the elastic modulus. People have also seen large changes in the yield strength or the elastic limit of the material also with change in grain size. Now, you can see here that the grain size here is plotted as d to the power half and not as a function of d. But I think all of these are just, comfortable ways of plotting to get a particular trend going. But this is why we are going to look at microscale data. Again, microscale, people have also seen that just when you decrease the dimension of the specimen itself, there is going to be a change in the yield strength. Last slide, I told something about the grain size and the microstructure. But if you just make a pillar which is this size and then reduce it and reduce and reduce it further, then people have seen that the stress at which the failure occurs, which is actually a normalized quantity, that is also changing. And so that is what is plotted here as an example for different metallic materials, gold, copper, nickel, and so on. So what is plotted on the dependent axis or the y-axis is the yield strength that people have measured. And on the independent variable is what is the specimen size D. Forget what it is normalized with, it doesn't matter. So you can see that this is a log plot, by the way. You can see that there is a consistent trend of increasing strength with decreasing diameter of the sample. So smaller is stronger. That is what is the, buzz phrase that is used to describe this phenomena. And people were interested in why this is happening and whether if the yield strength goes up, then the load bearing capacity of the material actually goes up, right? I can use it at higher loads. So people were interested in measuring these things. So if one tries to measure it in tension, it is possible to measure it in tension, but there are lots of difficulties. But I will still show a micro scale tensile test, which is very much like what Professor Preeta Pant was showing in macro scale, but you now see certain differences. You see, there is these load drops that you're seeing, or corresponding stress drops. Let me call them as stress drops. So every time there is some band appearing here, you see these drops in the stress strain curve. And this is what you'll also see in the micropillar compression data. And that is the only reason I showed this. So this entire sample is in tension, and it's a single crystal. It's not a polycrystal. So something is happening here. Again, details of which we don't want to get into. But because of that phenomena, each time this band appears, there is a drop in the load or the stress. And if you reload, you can continue to plastically deform that sample. So again, you can see that there is a portion which is linear elastic, which has a straight line slope that can be calculated, and you can get the elastic modulus or Young's modulus of the material, which is exactly what Professor Peetapan was saying. But you also see that initially the loading is not straight, right? So it has some problem here. So this is the part or range of data that you have to avoid. And now this comes because of the experimental error. When you have to clamp a specimen which is so small, you cannot hold it very tight initially. So you end up, you know, holding it a little loose. So it is initially doing a little bit of a pre-stress. So that region that you see here is the pre-stress region. This region. Okay. So after that, when you continue to pull, it will become straight and it will show the material behavior. So up to this point, it is not actually the material behavior. It's got something to do with the machine and the materials interaction. So aligning the sample and pulling it straight is all a difficult task. And that's the reason we go for the compression test, which is a reverse test, but which will give more or less the same yield strength for most materials, not all. Again, let me not generalize. So this is a single crystal of barium titanate, which is an oxide crystal. It's a ceramic, but in compression, it will undergo deformation. Whereas if I pulled it in tension, it would have just broken like chalk. Okay? So this is the pillar we are talking about. And there is a punch, which is sort of pushing that pillar down, and we are going to measure. So all of these is at the very small length scale. So you see that, you know, the entire instrument of measurement itself goes into the, you know, fits into the palm of your hand, and it goes inside what is called as a scanning electron microscope. And you can watch what is happening even at the length scales. Here you can see the scale bar is 0.5 microns. So even at these length scales, you can see what's going on. You can also collect the information, the data that is obtained as this material deforms. And you can see again that there are these bands forming as the material deforms, although not very clearly as in the tension test. So it's very good to do these, you know, uniaxial compression or tension tests, and even better is a compression test because it's easy. And you can measure the cross section at area and convert it into a stress. But there are some problems. Like I said, I will just quickly talk to you about what are the sources of error in the experimental measurement itself, in the data itself. One is that because the sample is so small, it is still held to the bulk, and you have to paste the bulk sample onto something. So if that pasting is not straight and perpendicular to the punch that is coming in, then you will have a tilt, and because of which the contact that is initially made may not be exactly flat with respect to the sample. It may have this kind of tilt, and so it is not going to be uniaxial. Then there is this thing that the way this is machined, the pillar is not, it's still a part of the substrate. It is attached to the substrate. So there is this, you know, the springiness of the substrate also contributes to the deformation. So that is called as compliance. And that also adds. Then the fact that this is not an exact cylinder, but it has a taper. It's almost like a conical shape. So where do you measure the cross-sectional area from? So where do you measure the diameter, first of all? Should I measure it here or here at the base? Usually the material deforms in the region where you have the smallest cross-section area. So we end up taking this so-called protocol is to measure right at the top, because you cannot avoid the taper while making these kinds of pillars. So these are parts of the experimental error. Now, our objective is to determine the dependence of the yield strength on the specimen size in this single crystal barium titanate material. So the data that we will be giving you is related to this, and I will just take you through what we have done to obtain whatever we have, and you will repeat that in the R session. Okay, so we have taken, let's say, four different sizes of the pillars. We have made what is called as focused ion beam machining. It's a micro machining technique. It can be used to make different sized pillars. So I have taken 5 micron size. We have taken, this is Nidhin's data, by the way. So 5 micron, he has taken 2 micron, 1 micron, and 0.5 micron. So these are the different sizes of the pillars that he has taken. And all of them have been deformed. And you can see that there are these bands in all of these samples. But there are also cracks in the larger sample and a little bit of the crack initiating in the intermediate sample, and there are no cracks in the smaller samples. Okay, and the stress strain curves from the load displacement curve, if you convert it to an engineering stress strain curve, you get plots like this for different sizes. So for 5 micron, you see this is the pink curve, and with the decreasing size, you see that the curve, you know, continues to remain elastic to a larger and larger stress value. Forget about what is happening later. So you can see that what is called as the elastic limit is different for each of these different sizes. That is very clear to us. So how do you determine where exactly the elastic limit is? One thing that I already talked about is that there are lots of errors in the measurement, especially in the strain measurement of such small samples. So we don't really trust the strain that we get directly from the measurement. So what we trust is the load, though. So in the instrument, the load is trustable. The strain is not directly trustable as is given from the machine. So what we end up doing is doing a linear fit and finding out the point at which there is a deviation from linear elastic behavior, and consider that itself as the yield strength. Again, to fit also, you should not be, so if this is the raw data, right? So you should not be fitting, you should not be trying to fit a linear fit to the whole thing, because then it will not fit. So you'll have to leave out a certain percentage of the initial contact. Again, this is happening because initial contact may not be exactly flat, like I was talking about. So there might be a slight tilt, so it is trying to adjust itself. So that is why initial is non-linear. And then once everything is pakka, then it is linear. So this part needs to be left out. So you can do it, you know, just by the your eyesight, you can say that, you know, I'll take from this point to this point of linear fit, or you can fit it into two different linear curves and find the point where there is a transition and use that part to fit linear. So you can be on the safer side and choose the region which is completely linear and then extrapolate it. And the point at which the actual curve deviates from that linear fit is taken as the yield strength. So you can, of course, get a fitting equation, and you can do this in your R session. Okay, so the fit for 2 microns, let's say, is the curve looks like this. For 1 micron, the noise becomes higher because the loads that the instrument is measuring is now lower. So the noise becomes higher. So there are ways that you can smoothen the data also if need be. We are not going to do it here because this is smooth enough for our purpose. So now we plot. So let's say I have taken the yield strength at different diameters. Then let's then plot the independent variable. In this case, what we take as the independent variable is the specimen size, and the dependent variable, which is the elastic limit or the yield strength. And that helps us identify, so once you plot this raw data, it helps you identify the trend. So that is what is plotted, pillar diameter versus normal stress at failure. So there are these groupings, right? So that you see that this is a scatter plot. And when you plot in the form of a scatter plot, each of the data point is represented in the curve. So you can actually count the number of measurements that we made in this particular experiment. So let's say at about 4.5 microns, I have about 8 data points here. It's not very clear because some of them are overlapping. But for each of the sizes, we at least have about 6 measurements, and all the way going up to 10 to 12 measurements. So you can count it very clearly here. So what are the observations that we make? We make the following observations, right? One is that this is not a linear trend for sure, right? See, even if I try to fit, I can fit a linear maybe only to these two. Or, I mean, of course, with 2 data points, you can always fit a linear curve. So where is the linearity? Maybe these 3, but then this is not going to fit the same. So if I try to fit these 2, then these 2 are not going to. So this is clearly not a linear trend. So it's also known from the physics that this is not supposed to be a linear trend. So we will try to fit it in a different way. But in the process, you also observe that at larger pillar diameters, the normal stress, the failure stress or the yield strength is all crowded at almost close to each other. Whereas as you decrease the pillar diameter, the spread in the data is also increasing, right? So you have the data points that are recorded, which are over a wider
range. And further, it becomes more when you go to 1 micron and 0.5 micron. Again, these are due to various reasons. Some of them are extrinsic, but some of them are intrinsic reasons for the error. The one reason that why you have a smaller scatter at the 5 micron is because you can measure a 5 micron diameter very clearly, whereas a 0.5 micron or a 1 micron diameter pillar, the taper is more, so the measurement becomes more erroneous. That is one, but that's an external, let's say, reason. But there is an internal mechanism reason why you have a you know, smaller spread here and a wider spread here. And that is because of the reason why it would deform at 5 microns is different from the reason at which it would deform here. Okay, so at for small sizes, the material reaches what is called as its theoretical strength. And that is what it is trying to reach. So it's a more statistical process. It depends whether it finds a source or not and so on. So that is why you have a larger scatter here. So what we can do is, instead of, you know, finding out the mean and the standard deviation first, we can try to fit it into a trend that we would like to see. What we're interested is in finding the size exponent. So, like I said, for the size exponent, we will sort of find out up to what point we need to do these measurements. So, what are the limits? What are the bounds? So, at about 4.6 GPA or so and above, this material's theoretical strength is known. So, this has crossed that. Okay. So, we will not consider the 0.5 micron for our fitting at all, because this has now stabilized. It has become horizontal, right? And on the other end also, it seems like if you take these three data points also, it seems like it is going to plateau somewhere. And that is really the case, that at far away, like for very large samples, you have something called as a critical yield strength, which is much smaller, which is about 0.1 GPA. And that is the limit on the other side. So that limit is drawn here. Okay. So we have the data only to fit the data, it's only available for, let's say, three clusters or three groups of diameters, sample diameters. And these, if you notice, the diameter is also not a fixed quantity. You can see small variations even in the diameter. So you can also plot and see later what is the scatter and the mean and the standard deviation in the pillar diameter itself. Because when you micro machine, you cannot make an exactly you cannot make an exact size of the specimen. There will always be some variations, which is acceptable, which is not large. This is a small variation. So this data is known to follow a power law with what is called as a size effect power law. So there is an exponent n associated with that. D is again the pillar diameter. Sigma naught I was talking about is the far field macro scale elastic limit or yield strength of the sample, which is 0.1 GPA, and that is known already. So we need to fit a curve accordingly. So what best way to fit it is that we can take a log-log plot. We can shift the sigma naught on the left-hand side and then take a log on both sides. When you do that, then you get the functions for the intercept, which is log K, and the slope of the curve will be minus N. Or n rather, in absolute quantity. So that is what was done here. So logarithm of the pillar diameter versus the logarithm of sigma y minus 0.1 GPA. This is all in GPA, by the way, is what is plotted. And you can now try to fit it into a linear graph. This one, like I said, we are going to leave out. So because this is sort of stabilizing beyond 1 micron or less than 1 micron pillar diameter, it has reached the theoretical strength. It will not go beyond that. So that is why we leave it. So this has been plotted and you will see certain intercepts and coefficients coming up here. So you can again check these numbers, what you get when you plot it. We have got an intercept of 1.4, which means exponential of 1.4 will be the value of K. And the slope is minus 0.88, which means the exponent, the size exponent so-called, should be around 0.88. And this has given some R-square value, which is acceptable, which is 0.96 or so. This is again using R, which Sushil, Kevin, and Tejas have helped me today morning with, just to check whether it was going to give something similar or different. So if you assume that the data was all normal it was, you know, showing a normal distribution, then it fits into that kind of an equation. But if you plot the residuals, I think Professor Gurarajan is a better person to talk about this. But this shows that although there is scatter at both plus minus, it's not a random scatter. Okay, so it's not a normal scatter that you see. So this shows a pattern which is different from a normal distribution. So the regression analysis tells us that there is something else and that this data is not normally distributed. So the student has actually used some other distribution when he wrote this particular paper, which is called as a t-distribution for individual data points. I will again not go into the details of that. But when it was fitted, it gives you this particular value. And since we did not, I wanted to point out that since the student was not using R, and so he had to plot in origin, so that did not allow him to plot both of them together for some reason. So there is a 95% confidence interval that's plotted differently from the actual fit. But in R, I'm sure this allows for all of these to be viewed together. So do plot it. Then if I just look at the last part of the data, if I plot for each of these individual, you know, spread in the data for each of the pillar diameters, let's say I have about 10 to 12 data points at 1 micron. And again, I have about 8 to 10 data points at 5 micron. If I want to look at the spread in the data, one way is to just calculate the mean and the standard deviation, which you will learn how to do, and it will give you certain values. But if you do it in the form of a box plot, then you can see that the median is not the same as the mean, and that the median is skewed. Okay, so the median is skewed to the left in both these cases, and that tells you that the distribution is not normal again. And this tells you that 50% of the data points lie within this. It doesn't look like it has outliers, but it has a, again, the 1 micron has a very large spread, whereas this one has a smaller spread. So the last part I wanted to show you is from this particular paper, which talks about not the external sample dimension, but the internal sample dimensions, what are called as, like I talked about, the grain boundaries. Let's say you have multiple boundaries and those boundaries become smaller and smaller, then there's also possibility to calculate the size exponent for the boundary spacing now. And that is what was done. I will not go into the details because it's a very similar analysis, but it is done, it's done in a very nice way. They have assumed a normal distribution because I think they have checked it and they have found that the data is in fact normally distributed. So this is the same thing, strength as a function of now the spacing internally. And you can see that the spacing is very fine. The scale bar here is 200 nanometers. Okay, so one can look at the data individually. If you look at the data, then you see that this is a scatter plot. And then you also see the fit for that scatter plot and the fit and the you know, accuracy and the error associated with the fits itself have also been calculated. So I will just stop there. So just to state that the measured data itself is never exact. It always contains errors. So one has to be mindful of that. I think we showed, so Pita Pant already showed you that you need to fit a linear slope to a curve. I also used it for some other purpose. So she used it to calculate the elastic modulus and I used it to calculate the deviation so that I get what is called as the yield strength. Then we also showed, didn't show how to make a box plot, but I showed you a box plot and a scatter plot. And since we did not have initially, the data was not in the form of it was not showing a linear trend. So we transformed it such that you can fit it into a linear model. So that is what we did. And I didn't touch upon this, how to determine error and uncertainty in the error itself, but I showed you those residuals and I hope that Professor Gurarajan can take over and talk about it, maybe with this or some other example.